Welcome back to Films Recapped. Today I will show you a post-apocalyptic, sci-fi action movie from 2013, called Snowpiercer. Warning! Spoilers ahead. Watch out and enjoy. To combat climate change, scientists intend to inject CW7, a cooling substance, into the top of the Earth in 2014. Unfortunately, the experiment fails, bringing about a new ice age that kills everything by freezing it to death. Only a select few fortunate people who board a train after the end of the world live. The scenario for the tail compartment further worsens as the train continues to run in 2031, 17 years later. Wealthy people ride in the front of the train, while the poor are seated in the back. Poor people are mistreated by security personnel, who only give them protein bars to eat. Some others, including Curtis Everett and his deputy Edgar, find the situation intolerable, but they are unable to do anything about it right now. One day they get a top secret letter informing them of Nam Kong Su, a security expert who is now being held in the prison sector. Nam Kong Su is mentioned as having been detained there, because Nam is the only person who can assist them. Curtis and his boss Gilliam intend to remove him and use his presence to open the gates to other sections that will lead them to the front. The only way to gain control of the train, according to Gilliam, is to seize the engine. Curtis views Gilliam as a father figure and a potential leader, and he has suggested to Gilliam that he take over as captain of the engine in place of Welford. Edgar, a little boy who is close to Curtis, frequently talks about his preparations for the uprising. Although he disagrees with the notion, he believes Curtis should take over as mission leader after Gilliam. While they are still speaking, a few guards approach their compartment and order the parents to remain back while the children are asked to come forward for a medical inspection. Timmy and Andy are hauled away after the inspection while their parents wait behind, sobbing for them. They punish Andy's father Andrew by putting one of his hands outside in the snow after he snaps and kicks Minister Mason with a sneaker. Speaking to the others, Mason chastises them for putting the shoe on her and warns them from making any foolish moves against her. Everyone is serving their predetermined roles, according to her, and if they refuse to accept their fate, the results will be disastrous. Frostbite damages Andrew's arm, which the guards were forced to amputate. Gilliam urges Mason to tell Wilford that he wants to talk to him after covering his injured body. Curtis speculates that the guards are using empty weapons because they ran out of ammunition during a previous uprising. He prepares to attack them, but Gilliam dissuades him by pleading with him to wait. They decide to walk ahead to the front compartment and operate the engine, as Gilliam had suggested. The people in the tail section free Nam by killing a guard with their hidden weapons and stealing his keys. Edgar lets him out by opening the drawer. When Curtis begs him for assistance and he declines, they offer him his preferred drug Cronol, which also works as a combustible substance, in exchange for opening the gates. He debates with them for a while before deciding to assist them, but requests to bring his daughter, Yuna, along. As they move forward, they are unable to locate anyone. They have a chance to see outside via the windows while investigating the compartment, but there is no trace of any life on Earth. They learn about the following section from clairvoyant Yuna, who also happens to be the cook for the protein blocks, Paul. They learn from Paul that he utilizes insects to produce those protein bars, but Curtis urges his pal to keep this information a secret from the other group members. They learn something about the water supply portion while conversing with them that suggests they should be in control of that rather than the engine. Where water is gathered and recycled for drinking, Paul specifies the place. Paul and Gilliam talk about the problem, and Gilliam advises that if they treat it as the most important component and manage to get their hands on it, they won't need to take control of the engine. Yuna is asked by Curtis where she learned about life off the train, but he soon realizes that she was born on the train. She yells at Nam, pleading with him not to open the door next to him, but it is already too late. They encounter an army of guards carrying axes and other such weapons. They are attacked by the guards before they can react, and they begin to fight back. The captain says they have arrived at the Yekaterina Bridge, which represents the passage of a year on the train as it completes one round on its track, following an intense encounter fight in which Edgar and Curtis fight side by side. Mason reappears and chastises the men from the tail section for creating a mess. As she speaks, the train pulls into a pitch-black tunnel, giving troops with night vision the upper hand as they begin beating the passengers. After setting the torches on fire and murdering several of them, Curtis and his men prepare a counterattack, but Edgar is also fatally stabbed. Mason is being held captive by Curtis as he reaches over and orders her to stop the security guards. As the train emerges from the tunnel, Gilliam orders the survivors to prepare for the upcoming battle, while Curtis sits by Edgar's lifeless body in sadness. Mason confesses that she gave their children to Wilford after being tortured by Tanya and Andrew for asking about their children. They accept her offer to accompany them to the front compartment in exchange for her life. When Curtis is questioned about his future plans at night by Gilliam, he replies that he is still resolved to proceed. Following the discussion, Gilliam decides to hang back while Curtis moves on to the following sections with the help of Nam, Yuna, and a capable fighter named Gray. Gilliam briefs them on the front compartments before departing, and he designates Curtis as the new leader of the tail section. They enter an aquarium and an artificial garden as they continue on. In the front compartments, Mason offers them sushi while explaining that it is only offered twice to maintain the balance of meals. As the train travels through the remains of human civilization, everyone begins to eat. However, Curtis coerces Mason into consuming a protein bar from the tail compartment. Andy and Tanya start seeking for their kids in the kids' compartment after going through the meat department, but they are unable to locate them. The instructor explains Mr. Wilford is the one who developed this self-sustaining train while playing a movie about him. The film shows that Wilford built a luxurious locomotive with a specific track that rounds the Earth despite knowing the ramifications of CW7. They celebrate the new year at Yekaterina Bridge on a train voyage that takes almost a year to complete and is capable of withstanding the bitter cold of the Arctic and the sweltering heat of Africa. She also takes them outside to show them a few frozen bodies of people who left the train thinking they might live, but who only made it a short distance before freezing to death. Everyone receives New Year's eggs after the lecture, but they quickly reveal to be a trap as the guards once more bring out their concealed weapons and start attacking those in the back. Frank, one of Mason's pals, executes Gilliam after making it to the back of the group and sends the video to the class. In response, Curtis shoots Mason out of rage, but this sparks a battle in which the guards kill Andrew. As they move closer to the front portion, they observe how the wealthy are going about their everyday lives in a normal manner. Frank and Curtis start firing at each other as the train over a circular bridge, but they manage to stay alive, thanks to the bulletproof glass in the windows. Once inside the subsequent compartment, they lose Tanya and Gray in yet another altercation. Curtis, Nam, and Yuna arrive at the front gate after passing through several compartments in the rich sector, but Nam won't unlock it. He and Curtis fight, but Curtis calms him down by providing him a cigarette to smoke. Curtis describes their first days back in the tail compartment as they converse. He explains to him that because they had gone days without food, they began to consume weaker people, including kids. When Gilliam walked over and offered his arm in exchange for the life of the child one day as they were attempting to kill the youngster and his mother, Curtis made the decision to release Edgar. According to him, the experience caused everyone to start offering their own body parts to save others, which is how they came to regard Gilliam as their leader. He believes Wilford is to blame for everything, and he demands that he bear responsibility. Nam is moved by his tale, yet he states that he would like to open the gate to the outside. He claims that over the years, he has kept an eye on a few points and has learned that the snow has begun to melt, so he believes that they can now survive outside. When Claude attacks the fence that he is attempting to blow open, Curtis is invited to join Wilford for dinner in the front compartment. Wilford commends Curtis on getting it thus far as no one else could when he enters the cubicle. He explains to him how the train's internal system operates. He says they have to sustain the population, the water supply, and the food supply. In order to kill each other and decrease the population inside the train, they keep starting revolts. According to Wilford, Gilliam was their joint planner of this insurgency as well as past ones. They intended to terminate the conflict at Yekaterina Bridge, but when he launched the counterstrike, it only served to further their objectives and increase the death toll, for which Gilliam had to pay the price. Curtis finds it hard to believe him, but he calls the tail compartment to demonstrate his point. With a mandate to eliminate 74% of the population, he is led to the locomotive's engine by Wilford, who offers to steer the train in his place. Additionally, he delivers him a message that says he was the one who kept hinting at them. In order to keep the balance, he recommends Curtis take over the reins and leave everything alone. As they converse, Nam and Yuna struggle with the occupants in the front compartment and successfully open the gate. Wilford's plan seems to get Curtis on board, but when Yuna arrives and asks him to open the floorboard, they discover Timmy inside the vehicle serving as a slave to the engine. Wilford reveals that several engine components failed and required physical labor to function. Yet, the cramped space could only hold small infants, which is why people continued bringing kids from the tail compartments. Curtis frees Timmy, but as a result, he loses his hand. Meanwhile, Andy arrives and approaches the engine, ignoring Curtis's commands to stop. Wilford informs him that he won't listen to him because everyone is striving toward his predetermined positions. Yuna starts the fire that starts the explosion that blows the gate up in the meantime. It results in a large explosion that triggers an avalanche, which causes the train to crash. While everyone else perishes, Nam and Curtis use their bodies to protect Yuna and Timmy. Finally, Yuna and Timmy emerge from the derailment and spot a polar bear in the distance, proving that there is still life on Earth. Make sure to like, subscribe, and turn on notifications so you can watch more videos like this. Thanks for watching.